Well, I moved there actually for a relatively practical but very simple reason. A friend of mine from Lebanon had moved to Germany before me. He moved to Munich actually. So I just simply followed him. And then I studied classical music in Munich at the music high school there. And so that's I just ended up staying there. And you know, when my travels started, I just remained there.
And you actually work with a German record label as well now, don't you? Is that right,
With
Damien?
Insight, yes. Been working with them since, well, pretty much since the beginning, except for a few records that I've been produced on my own before I went to a record company.
Well, it's a good label.
It's, yeah, and they let me do what I want, which is very important for me.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you're making a special kind of music, really, aren't you? It's a very personal, particular type of sound that you have.
Well, it's actually nothing that you could think of commercially. It's not something that you would say, oh, I have to make a commercial record now and make some money. Let me bring a tuba player, a harmonica player, a percussionist, an accordionist. Just would not really work. So to be actually able to experiment with this and do something that is so unusual, I think you would have to have quite a bit of freedom. Otherwise, it just wouldn't be able to live out your thoughts.
To when you began learning classical and your music, was there some kind of conflicts that you found to trying to get them to work together?
Well, at the beginning, I didn't do that at all. At the beginning, in fact, I just thought, okay, you know, I'm here, I'm in the West now, there's a war going on in Lebanon, who knows when I'll be back. I have to adapt and be here. So my first thing was, I went really classical. It was a time, you know, it was the late 70s, early 80s. There was a time when nobody's ever heard of world music. You know, when I tried to do my first record, this was practically impossible to find a record company who would do it. So I had a very, I did not work on my music. I had left my oud for a few years. I studied the classical flute. I was into Bach, into all that things. And then, you know, it was one evening I still remember. I took out my oud and I thought, and I felt like there's something that I've really missed for a very, very long time. And in fact, I found myself playing differently right there. You know, thinking, oh, geez, I've played this a billion times, this lick, this scale, this moment, this rhythm. And you know, I just started realizing how much how redundant it has been what I have been doing in certain ways. And I think that did certainly change me. So I stopped playing classical music, stopped playing so-called traditional. I was just doing my own thing. I don't, music to me, even back then, has not been about presenting a certain tradition or a certain culture. It's been a sensual art. It's not something about, my first concern wasn't what style will I get into. My first concern was how will I get the right expression? How can I bring emotions across? How can I get sensuality across? And was really very little concerned about, oh, should I stay in this style? I mean, you know, naturally coming from a society like this, I always get a lot of people telling me this is not real Arabic music, like there's anything that's real. And, you know, the idea of anything pure is fascist. You know, there's nothing pure about anything. There's no purity of race, there's no purity of art, there's no purity of culture. There's nobody invented anything, even the history of cultures is the history of plagiarism. Everybody's copied everybody, and
Most of
it's
it's
when you turn
fiction.
it, yeah, it's when you turn it into something of your own and continue it. That's actually when something happened. And as we can see in music, the real innovations have always been when two cultures met. I think for, you know, 20th century, the only really interesting development in music, something really new of the 20th century was jazz. And that was the meeting of Africa and the West.
West.
You know, and look where it got. It's become an art form. It's become now just a square to play jazz as it is as to play classical. You know, instead of people coming out playing the bebop and sounding like John Coltrane, which is great. You know, it shows you how it has turned, become something classical.
But I think that's also because of the I think that's also because of the bounds that the European culture has held on jazz. Because if you look at the way jazz has been promoted, I mean, it hasn't really. It's what Europe does is with the music is that they turn it into a product, and then music has a problem with that.
Yeah.
Once you box something, it's.
Yeah. It's when you classify it and you start, right. You go into the concert and your first thought is, now where shall I put this?
Yeah.
Because I often hear, what do they call your music? What do they call your music? Right. So, what they call my music is actually really not even so much of a concern. Even jazz wasn't a word that was invented by jazz musicians.
No.
Neither was baroque, neither was classical. It's always the
marketeer.
Yeah, it's somebody who thinks of something. What's a hip name? Jazz.
Yeah.
I wish I could find something that's hip for me. Well, the recent record is pretty much the wildest one I've done. It's in Portuguese. It's with a Portuguese singer.
Yeah.
And it's they're Portuguese texts, Portuguese poems that I actually put music to. And singer sings with my band. So it's a very odd... I started that project without speaking a word of Portuguese too soon.
Wow.
So that was that was quite a wild beginning, and it took quite some time during which I worked very closely with the poets and with the singer, just so I can get all the intonations right. And it's a fado singer who comes from, it's not fado at all, it's still my music, it's my stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But they're songs, they're Portuguese songs.
Mm-hmm. That's
so that's my first vocal record.
The first time you worked with Portuguese?
Yeah, well, that's what a lot of people ask me, well, why not Arabic? It's because I didn't find the right Arabic. It's not that I look for people, I just find them, just find something. And but in this case, it was actually started as an idea from a theater in Porto, from the National Theater. The director there, he liked my music, and he asked me if I would like to work with a Portuguese singer. And I said, well, anything's possible, just seems to be an odd thing, since considering I've never worked with a singer before, let alone a Portuguese. I don't speak a word of Portuguese, and I don't really know much about Fado either. I mean, I've heard the music, but... Mm-hmm. So we started the first project, which went okay, but wasn't perfect. But it started getting me going then.
Mm-hmm.
Then I started really getting into it and pushing it. And then I found I found a singer, Ricardo Ribeiro, who's a fado singer, never done anything else. Young man of 26 and with an incredible voice and does things that I don't know how he does them. He just hears the music, he gets the rhythms right.
Yeah,
he just hears the, whatever it is he does, he hears the rhythms, the rhythm changes, the modes, the scales. And so we've been working together pretty much a bigger part of last year.
And what's the name of the album?
It's called Em Português.
Em Português.
Em Português.
Yeah.
Which means in Portuguese.
Yeah. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Straightforward.
It's very simple, yeah.
Straight.
Did you design the cover for that one as well?
I did, yeah.
Yeah.
That's one of the fun parts that I do.